so anyway, then began this question of thought reform. So we sat around in a circle on this, it was called a cog, this sort of platform. And we did a number of things. One of the things we would do, we would have study set periods in which we would study about socialism or women's rights or, you know, any of the issues that came along during the time. We would read documents. Well, most of the people are illiterate, so we would read them aloud. We would go through a regular reading, and then we would go through a fast reading, it would be called, and then we'd go through slow readings in which you would, well, maybe paragraph by paragraph, and you would discuss these things and so on. And then after that, you would discuss how you felt about these things. And of course, what was interesting was that you found immediately there was a wide range of opinion in the cell. We were all anti-communist, there's no question about that, but that we were, well, for instance, several of the people were landlords, and they couldn't understand what they had done that was terribly wrong. Well, when any one of them would try to justify charging the peasants something like 100 to 125% interest in the spring of the year when the old grain has gone out and the new grain hasn't come in yet and the peasant is starving and he needs seed grain in order to survive, you know, I, as an American, that didn't sit well with me at all. On the other hand, every time I opened my mouth, this stupid landlord could hear American imperialism coming out. It was just, you know, just that way. And so there was this, a lot of discussion that went on that was real discussion. Of course, we all, when we first went in, tried to claim that, you know, that we loved communism, we loved socialism, land reform was great, all that sort of thing. But then, you know, the communists simply pointed out if we really felt that way, we shouldn't be in the prison to begin with. So how did we get there if that was how we felt about it? So, you know, you had to be somewhat realistic. And then we began dealing with, you know, more personal problems of really how you felt about things. And a lot of the discussion was sort of pointless, and but some of it really sort of hit the mark. For example, well, the first time we were told we should discuss women's rights. If you can imagine a group of about 8-10 men sitting around in a circle being told they have to discuss women's rights. Well, our feeling was, you know, if they want them, let them have them. I mean, and we, you know, the, we most of we'd all been married at least 5 years, and you know, our wives were happy. There was no problem with our wives, you know. So, you know, what was the big deal? Well, anyway, something happened one day that changed that, and that was that one of the fellows was called out of the cell, and when he came back, he was looking very grim, and it turned out his wife had asked him for a divorce. And when we asked him about it, how he felt about it, his response was typical male. He didn't care. He'd been fed up with her for a long time, and he'd have kicked her out if he hadn't been so soft-hearted and so on and all that sort of thing. In those days, you could kick out a wife under the Kuomintang. Anyway, it obviously didn't solve his problem because he kept walking up and pacing up and down the cell, bumping into things, staring off into space, and he was really upset. So one day, when we asked him about it, and our study sessions, you know, ranged from about 6:30 in the morning. Well, we got up at 6:30, and then we washed and so on. By 7, we started our discussions. They went to about 9 when we had breakfast, and then from about 10 through until about 2 in the afternoon, 2:30 in the afternoon, when we would then have our second meal, and then we would have rest until about 6, and then we would talk until about 9. So there's a lot of discussion went on. And so anyway, what happened was that he said, you know, once that he really couldn't understand it because they'd always had such a happy marriage, why his wife would be leaving him. So we decided to discuss this happy marriage, and we got talking about it. Well, one of the things that happened, came up almost immediately, was that he had married his wife up in Manchuria. At that time, he'd been working in a bank up there. And he had turned Christian in order to marry his wife, who was a Christian convert. And shortly after the marriage, his wife's younger sister had come to live with him so she could go to school in Mukden. And, he'd sort of taken her as a concubine. And his wife definitely was not happy about that. In fact, he said she'd cried solidly for a month or so and kicked up such a fuss that finally he had solved the problem by marrying the younger girl off to a friend of his in the bank. And this sort of things like that kept popping up. Perhaps the worst was that... one of the worst was that right before liberation, he was at that time a captain in the Kuomintang secret police. The youngest daughter took ill, and his wife wanted him to take the child to the hospital. And he said he would know. He felt it was just a common cold. Besides, he was busy. He was going off to play poker. The Chinese are fanatics on poker. Anyway, he went off to play poker. He was gone for 3 days, came back, he'd lost his shirt, the child was dead, it turned out it was encephalitis. And his wife couldn't stop her crying, he'd had to slap her around a little bit, and he'd had to pawn her wedding ring to buy a coffin for the child because he'd lost his shirt in a poker game. And as you can see, it was a very happy marriage. Well, we spent about a little over 2 weeks discussing his happy marriage. You know, it took that long before the guy could see any reason at all why his wife might want to divorce him. Even then, he never brought up the fact that the reason he was in prison was because when the Chinese went into North Korea, he thought that there was going to be an American landing in North Korea very quickly. And so he and some of his friends decided to organize sort of a welcoming committee. And to prove their diligence and loyalty, they set a small hotel on fire that happened to have some communists living in it. And for this bit of brilliance, he was now spending the rest of his life perhaps in prison or being executed. And of course, his wife had never been consulted in this at all. She just had to support the family on her own and so on. So she was getting a divorce. Well, anyway, after we got through with his happy marriage, then we went into all our happy marriages. And it was a good 6 weeks that we spent on our happy marriages. All of us, as I said, had been married at least 5 years. All of us, we had to admit that perhaps the worst we, however, couldn't imagine it to begin with was that, you know, we hadn't helped our wives with the dishes or something of that kind. Trivial stuff, but actually very quickly it came out it was much more serious than that. It turned out I was the only person in the cell who had never struck his wife. And they said the only reason I hadn't was because I didn't dare. One fellow had kicked out his first wife, a peasant woman, married a sing-song girl who has turned out to be tubercular. He mistreated her so badly, she threatened to commit a suicide, so he handed her a knife and told her to go out and do it and get out of his sight and stay out. And that was the end of that. One after another story of that kind. And by the time the discussion was over, you know, as far as really getting it, none of us did. But we did, I think, begin to realize that if we ever did get back home and we ever did, and our wives were still with us, we were going to have to adopt a slightly different attitude. And it was the beginnings of something. And I think as much as these things can, it was fairly effective. Now, the thing about it is, of course, is that there's no such thing as final reform. You know, you don't, for instance, an alcoholic or somebody like that who comes home drunk, beats up on his wife, and then the next day is terribly remorseful about it and so on. He can feel terrible about it, but that doesn't mean that he's going to reform, that he's reformed.